to be very ambitiously finding a theory of everything. So you would like to have a theory from which you could predict so much as possible and possibly everything. But I think it is usually an exaggeration to say that it even is everything one talks about, because you normally think, if I can tell which type of particles exist and how they interact with each other and how they develop as time goes on, this would be enough. This would be the theory of everything. But there is, after Newton, you should have in mind that there is this separation in two sorts of informations. There is the equations of motion, which is what is the way that the object developed, and how they also, including somehow, also what objects, which is really another thing. But what things do you have possibilities for having, and so on? This is the one thing, and then you could have the other thing is, so to speak, the start, or the what really happens in a way, because even if you know, or normally have some standing here and then on balcony or so, and then you let an apple fall down, and then the apple falls down, and then you can make some nice equation of motion and determine how fast it falls down, and there's a fall law that the distance it has fallen is a gravitational constant times t squared. I think this is, if you wait 1 second, it goes the half of 9.8 meters. And if you wait 2, it goes a half of 4 times the 8.9 meters, and so on. And that's a nice falling law. But you need to tell when the apple will fall down. You need to know when you let it loose. And also you need to know whether you would throw it up or throw it down, because that would completely change the situation. If you throw it down, it will come faster. If you throw it a little bit up, it could come much later. If you throw it high up. So it is, you need some initial conditions or starts. And usually you don't count that these initial conditions are required to have the theory of everything. So this is a de-ambition, but it's too ambitious anyway, even if you don't do it. But in a moment I would like to tell that we got somehow notorious for the proposal of how one could hope to make a theory where you even got the initial condition. That would be nice, but that would be too ambitious. And it is, because it failed a little bit. But it predicted that the great accelerators, which are very famously working now, Large Hadron Collider, which I would like to talk about more, actually shouldn't work. And now it works, since a year or so. So it's not so good prediction. But that you can try to predict things like that for the future, I think that's interesting, even if it turns out not to be extremely successful in the first go. Then, well, okay, you know how theories go when you when the theory don't work, you give it a little crutch, and then you make a better theory, well, a worse theory usually, more complicated, and therefore less likely to be true. But then you fit it in and get the things to work. And this you can do, and then you may say, it should be only machines which produce a lot of Higgs's are killed. The other ones are out to live. So if it keeps down not producing so many Higgs's, then it is allowed. Now I mentioned this word Higgs, which is a new particle, and I think this deserves to be mentioned. It's called after a Scottish physicist who were among the ones who first found the idea of the Higgs. This particle was basically found in December last year. Well, when the experimentalists presented it, they were very reluctant. This is very uncertain and so. If I had presented it, I would say, now we found the Higgs. But that you shouldn't say, because very often when you have something that is equally certain in the experiment as this Higgs was in this connection, then you find that it is not working anyway, that it is wrong. For instance, there was some of you may have heard about also last year that there was a famous neutrinos run faster than light. And if you shouldn't have heard that it died, then you hear it now. So it was not so successful. And this had 6 standard deviations, the Higgs had 3. But recently the Higgs has been a little bit improved in reliability from the Tevatron in USA. Anyway, the Higgs is a particle that should be there to provide non-zero masses to other particles, and one has therefore had reason to believe the Higgs should exist, and it is theoretically very needed, and now it was basically found, but not convincingly. So now I mentioned this. But I'm now in this moment somehow talking a little bit personally, that one of the things I did as young when I did science, that was to be a kind of father, but a bad father, to string theory, which is a theory which is still not killed, but it's in a way having one of its worst moments just now, because this LHC machine is looking for some results of the string theory, of the superstring theory, and until now nothing was found. But of course, machine runs, and the longer you wait and nothing finds, the worse it is for the probability that the theory is right. But we still, or some still believe it, but I'm the bad father, so I may not believe it, but of course, it is nice also that once none believed, some might have a good thing. Since something like when I was 30 or so, I switched to work on another theory which was basic. I should say that this string theory, when we worked on it in the old time, was not meant to be the theory of everything. But then later on in 1984, it became developed by people like Schwarz and Green and many others to become a theory that should be the theory of everything, hopefully. And therefore now it is very ambitious to hope that it will be the theory of everything, if it turns out right. Otherwise it's just a sort of mathematical theory. And I think the truth of the string theory is that it is mathematically exceedingly important, and that it is actually, as a mathematical theory, it is most popular. But then in some sense, without knowing it, I was working on what became the theory of everything. But in random dynamics, it is, in a way, an attempt to be the theory of everything. So in that sense, I have worked too much on this too ambitious project of finding theories of everything. And it is, of course, probably not so good. But anyway, and then I talked here about that we would like also to make initial conditions become into the theory. And that would screw up the level of ambition of the theory of everything. Because if I really could say, now we have a theory which predicts not only how things develop, but also how they started, and that you could say, now at least in principle, you just switch the computer on, and then the computer can determine everything. But it has to be a very good computer. It's very difficult, possible mathematically. But even if it was in principle possible that you could do really everything, this would be truly deserving the name of a theory of everything. So this would be the level most ambitious. And I shall very shortly tell you about this kind of theory that tries to get the prediction also of the initial conditions, and thereby trying to be, in this respect, a theory of everything, and not only in the respect of having all the particles right and so on. So that would be the thing. I should, yeah, this is very approximate glancing thing. So then I could also mention that I have become a member of the of actually two Videnskab and Selskab in Norway. And once I was receiving the honor in this, I was in front of people, and some people, one of which was the king. And I was bowing to the first one, and it was wrong one. So the king was making motions to tell me who was the right king. And I bowed to the right king. I have also been to many many skiing conferences, but it's essentially only one series of conferences, which was in sporting most of the time, until it went bankrupt. But then, I was usually the winner of this skiing competition we had, but from the wrong end. So I was the last one of them all. So it was almost a little not winning when there was one on the other side. So I was only number two from the wrong end or so. But then was a little premium in consolation that we won. There was a team where we were at a team, and then we could win, where I was one of them, and some Norwegian girl, etc., on the other in the team, and we got the prize for having been the most helpful, which means she had helped me so much that it was bigger help than in any other ones of the competitions, of the competing teams. So we won this prize, at least. So now, since I have started on this story of these predictions of the future, I think I will start by telling about that story a bit more in detail. And I have already stressed for you on the blackboard that we should separate our knowledge about physics to the equations of motion and the types of particles we have and so on. And later on I shall talk about the so-called standard model, which is a very good model for the high energy physics today. And this is so good that it's almost good enough. But it has a series of small mistakes. I can show for you some transparencies with the errors or the mistakes where the standard model doesn't work. And I need at least two transparencies to just list them. So they are somewhat, it's not good for a theory to have too many disagreements or even to have too many beauties, not so beautiful features. So it is not so perfect, but to tell the truth, I am one of the few who believes that it will work better than almost anybody else. So I have more confidence in the standard model than most other people, myself. And then, in addition to knowing these how things develop, once you know how they start, I stress that you also have this initial condition knowledge. And the initial condition knowledge, that of course really is how did the universe start in some sense. But and this I would also like to talk about in a moment, about that there is a Big Bang and how the very first, second history of the universe is going. But for the moment, I'm just stressing that there is this separation, and if you are really ambitious, you should get the verse, and you should make a theory for both of them. And we would like to do that, and if you really could make it for both of them, then you could calculate everything. And then, okay, you would have very ambitious theory. You could calculate everything, and it would be the truth if you managed to calculate. It would only be a mathematical problem to know everything. And you would actually, in our version of this, be able even to know something about the future. Now I could like to I think it is not I can put some way that this theory which we have, you know, me and me about that is called the complex action theory. But then I would need to tell a lot about what is the complex, what is an action, and if the one could wonder about it. But I think I would like perhaps first to give an idea how such actually the theory turns out. I think you should only consider this Feynman-Path integral as a sort of symbolic act, because I don't think I would really explain it to people who don't know it. I could return to it. But I think the main point of this kind of theory, that is, first, you have a functional. And this is this. This can be imaginary action, but I don't even have to tell what imaginary action is. But I could tell that I could have a quantity, a number, I could calculate from a given history. And I could call it just SI or so. And then, if there was, I mean, Can you imagine a function of a history? I mean, you could take the history of the world, but all what happens in all details, every little particle, every little molecule, and then you write it down, and then you have a computer producing one number out of this. And this is, of course, in principle possible. And this would be a function. And I could call this function SI, and it would be a function of the history. And it is not even so difficult to write down what this function could be, because we have a very similar function which is going into the description of physics and which is a real part of the action or so, and it is written in some simple theory and so on, and it would take a little time to tell it, but it wouldn't be worse than that we could write it down on a few transparencies, and after a few hours you would also know what we were talking about. So it is not so hopeless, but it would not be easy to calculate it, because just writing down the history in all detail is a hopeless game. But to calculate this formula for the history then becomes also hopeless, because history is too complicated. And therefore, you couldn't do that, but you could still think of doing it. And the principle behind could be moderately simple, only a few transparencies and so on. So we could imagine that. Now imagine we had a formula of a similar character, which was called the imaginary part of the action. And then we could formulate the theory, which Nilumia and I formulate, by saying, now we have a kind of God, and I think it's important to put him in quotation marks, because he's not a real God, but it is a kind of God in many respects. And then he could have the rule that now he finds the true, there are many, many possibilities for what could happen in the universe. Many, many, so many histories. And historians are making often counterfactual history. What would have happened if Hitler had won more and so on? And would there have then been a revolution afterwards, or would we all whatever? So there are many counterfactual histories possible, and enormously many on the microscopic level, and so on. So there are many. And now you imagine somehow that this God, he has his fantastic computer. He calculates for all possible histories the quantity SI, and then he looks up among those. Which one got the lowest number, the most negative number, out of this SI? And this most negative number, he says, this is my will. This is the history that should be done. That's what we are doing. So this would be a proposal. You could make the principles rather easy by making such an SI a rather easy functional, we call it. It is when it is a function of something so complicated as a history or of another function, we call it a functional rather than just a function. And then we could have that. And then you could imagine that he would calculate that. We could make some analogies to this and say, I think In this theory, it becomes a little bit analogous to that you have some marathon run or so. And then you ask the winner of the marathon run for the history of the run. And then you would be told the history about this. in the similar way as we are learning the history, say, from the beginning along, and we will follow, oh, what happened? I mean, he was just about breaking the leg, and what could happen? But we know that he is the winner, so we know that it's very unlikely that he could have gone a month in the hospital with a broken leg, go back and still win. So we are almost sure that he should not break his leg if he is the winner we are hearing. So in the same sense, if we are having the history that wins this SI game, then we are almost sure that this history should not have something that produces big positive contributions to SI. Because if it produced big positive contribution, it would be very likely, very unlikely, that it would be the history with the smallest SI. So now, if it is, as we are speculating, so that this type of particle called Higgs, which was essentially just discovered or just found at least, although not convincingly, then we would say, now we know, since we are in this history, it's very unlikely that a big amount of Higgses will be produced because they made a big positive contribution. It is like the marathon runner who had the win, having gone a big problem by falling down and breaking his leg and going to hospital and going back again to the same spot and so on according to the rules. So it would be very hard for to believe that. And in the same way, if this theory was right, and if it was right that SI was very sensitive to Higgses, then it would be so that it would be very unlikely that a big Higgs-producing machine should be allowed to come to work. So therefore, we made this now not so attractive idea, not so attractive story about the LHC that shouldn't be allowed to work, because the LHC has now at least produced so many Higgses that some of them have been seen. But that's still not so many. It has produced many more which were not seen. It's almost sure. Unless, of course, it is. The Higgs is so heavy or something that you can't see it. But I think it would be so. This NAC, if I shall talk a little bit about it, well, this is a bad drawing of LHC. But the principle is that you have two tunnels, and you send protons one way and the other way, and you send them with very high speed around. And now it is so, in series with Einstein's relativity theory, that you cannot have speed higher than speed of light. So this is the highest speed you can have, and even the protons where you do all your effort to give them as high energy as possible, and then even if you do that, and this energy which you give them, the plan would have been that one should have given them 7 TeV on 7 TeV, where TeV is a unit of it's a unit of energy. It doesn't really matter how what this energy unit is, but it is defined. You should have in mind that electric charge always comes in small integer numbers of some elementary quantum. And this elementary quantum is 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 Coulomb. Coulomb is the unit for electric charge. It's a very small